Morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to church on this fine, fine Sunday morning. I praise the Lord for every day he wakes me, for every day he gives me breath. So, Lord, we thank you and we praise you for this day to gather together as your body in your Son, Jesus Christ. Would you join with me in prayer? Lord, you are a good, good Father. You know us, Lord, even from the time of our conception, you know who we are in all the days of our life. So it is, Lord, we are so grateful for you, for all the days you have given us, that you have gathered us here together because we know, Lord, you are the one who calls us to yourself. So be with us this morning, Lord God, as we rise up to worship you, to praise you, to tend to your word, Lord God, to growing in knowledge of understanding of who you are in our life and who you call us to be for your life. We commit this time to you, Lord God. Bless us. And we pray that we will be a blessing to you as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good morning again.
Good morning.
Good morning.
News and announcements. The quarter two collection support missions near and far will be collecting quarters to fill the tube during our announcements. Upcoming events. Our Bible study on the book of Daniel will begin on Thursday, February 8th. There are two times available to meet for the study on Daniel. Thursday mornings at 10 and Thursday evenings at 6:30. And we're really looking forward to that. That's exciting. On Sunday, February the 11th, Bill Day from the Gideons. Bill Day is his name. It's not Bill Day. From the Gideons International will be here to share what the Gideons are doing to continue in the sharing of the gospel around the world. We will be taking up a special offering to support their mission to share the good news of Jesus Christ locally and abroad. Upcoming meetings. Our outreach and missions team will meet Tuesday, February 6th at 7 p.m. If you're interested in learning more about this ministry team and all that we do, you are invited to join. We will be meeting in the education building. And I'm going to put Dwight on the spot. I know we have an upcoming SPRC meeting. Do you have anything scheduled yet?
No.
Okay, we need to do that. Okay, because Pastor, I know, is awaiting his evaluation.
I'm encouraging him.
Eagerly awaiting.
Amen and amen. I invite you now to raise, as we worship our God and give him praise, singing, "Open my eyes that I may see." Once again, we thank you and we praise you for your goodness in our life. For every day, Lord, that we know you, we are blessed by you. And so we come before you, Lord God, as one body in Jesus Christ, to lift up our prayers to you, our joys, Lord God, the victories in our life for which you get all the glory, and those struggles in our life, the things that we're wrestling with, Lord, that we turn to you for direction, for comfort, for strength. And so I invite you who are here this morning to lift up your joys and your concerns to our Lord, our God. And I'd like to start off by lifting up our daughter. She let us know recently that she's going to have one more year of college to do. And as part of that process, she's also looking for a new job. And so just want to lift her up in prayers that the job that the Lord wants her to have, the one that will fit her hours and will be local so she doesn't have to travel too much, will be the job that she gets. So Lord, I lift up our daughter Jadine to you, that in this search for employment, Lord God, that you lead her to the right opportunity. And to those who are hiring, Lord, that you give them the wisdom to know that she is the best hire for the job. We commit her to your loving care in Jesus' name. Other prayers.
Well, my heart is so full of joy this morning to have Carol and Maureen with us. It's just like, what a blessing when I walked in and saw that little fuzzy gray hand sitting there. My heart was so full. I think I pushed people out of the way to get to her. But that's such a joy. And to have Alyssa and her children, my grandchildren by choice. It's just such a joy. And to see everybody here, it's just such a joy. And beautiful sunshine. Tired of the rain a little bit.
Lord, we do thank you for the life of Carol. What a joy it is to see her up and moving around. We give you all praise and glory for restoring her, renewing her, and giving her the strength, Lord God, to come home, to do the things you would have her do, and to gather together in worship with the body in Christ, Lord, that she knows and loves so deeply. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So I have a praise report on my friend Kelly's mom that was in the ICU for a week and a half in Riverside, and she is out of ICU. She's in she's still in the hospital, but she's doing better and better. So I just wanted to share that with you. I know you were praying for her. And then just want you to know that as I walk this journey, the Lord is definitely guiding me and holding me up and making things easier. And people are coming together and helping me, and I'm just so grateful for every bit of that. I want to keep Emil in our prayers. He leaves tomorrow. He'll fly to Seattle, and then from Seattle to Frankfurt, so he'll probably get there Tuesday at some time. So we want safe travels for him. And then Brandy was also down this weekend, so she'll be going over the pass to go back to San Diego tomorrow. So just... safe travels for both of them.
have a joy. We were able to, our missions group, go to the Senior Citizen Center on Friday, and we took soup and sandwiches and little goodies for them. And it's just such a blessing to be able to do that. And I'm just so grateful for that opportunity, because they're just so blessed, you know, and that's a real praise. And please just continue prayers for my daughter Stephanie, and especially for my grandchildren, because it's still a real rough road and things are really not the way I would want them to be, but God's got this, so just keep on your prayers, please. Thank you.
In Jesus' name, amen. Other prayers.
I want to thank God for the day of life. I thank God that he woke all of my family up this morning. I had a bit of a scare with my dad yesterday, but he is good, and I prayed over him. I just thank God that I was able to pray with him, and that he was able to have his anxiety that he had kind of go away after we prayed together. So I just thank God for him allowing just to use me to comfort my father, which is a blessing. It's a really big blessing for me. And for my dad, and so I ask that, you know, I lift my father up today, because I know that he's mentally struggling and physically, emotionally, and I want I just want to lift him up in prayer because I know he needs your guys' prayers.
There's power in prayer. There's power in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we pray all these things in your mighty name. Amen. Other prayers?
Yeah, it's really a joy to see Carol here. I get a chance to visit her at Clovis Community Medical Center Friday, and I didn't know that that would be her last day there. Apparently, she'd been there for 2 weeks, and she'd been told that she can go home, but still things were not final until, you know, I spent time with her, just holding her hand, being with her, letting her express to me everything, and we read scriptures, and we prayed, and then the call came that she was finally going to be discharged. So here she is today, and I was like, how I needed confirmation, you know. But then when I was at work yesterday, I saw your name, Carol, in our schedule this Monday for dialysis. I don't know if that's already your start day. 12:45 is your schedule, so I'm
like,
so I'm like, oh yeah, Carol is, you know, like you said, you will be doing in-center or outpatient dialysis. So I saw your name already. I'm like, I'm praying that it will be a blessing to you, that, you know, God will use me to help you and minister to you. So that's a prayer for sure.
Amen and amen. We thank you, Lord, for the goodness, your goodness in our life, for you are the one who sustains us, who renews us, restores us, who heals us and gives us strength. So, Lord, we continue to pray over the life of our church for all of our members, Lord, those who are here today and those who are not, to be with them. Continue, Lord, to pour out your spirit upon us, to build us up, to be a body, Lord God, which testifies to your goodness in our lives, to your amazing grace and the power of life that comes through faith in you and your Son, Jesus Christ. We continue to lift up those who you call and send out into the world, Lord God, to share the good news of your Son, who offers forgiveness of life and eternal life through faith in him. And so it is, Lord, that we pray together as one body in Christ in the way that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Power and the glory forever. Amen.
I just want to say that I always tell you that God has given me special blessings through the scriptures that he has me to read and share with you. And this morning I'm going to be reading from my Bible. It's going to be just a little bit different than what's up on the screen. I'm in the New International Version. And for a change, I'm going to ask you not to open your Bibles and not to look at the video up here, the screen, because I want you to really take this scripture into heart. Quite often we come and we hear things with our ears and we're trying to figure it out in our minds. This scripture really spoke to my heart today, and I want you to take it in. David is so special, as we know, special to God, and God was so special to him. And these things that God gave to David today for us to share as well shows you just how mighty and powerful God is, but how important we are as well to God. So here we go. Psalm 139. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on a far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become light, night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is a light to you. For you created my utmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you. When I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. Praise God for that. Our second, I feel like that's a testimony from David about just who God is, but also about who we are. That's our testimony as well that we share in. And the second reading is from Luke chapter 18, make sure I get it right, 15 through 17. This is really my heart's desire, has been all my life. It is a matter of testimony to me. It still is a deep desire and a longing for not just for whoever does not know God but needs to know Jesus and they need to come to him as a child. But Jesus used children specifically in this verse. They're so precious. And so here we go. Luke 18, 15 through 17. People were also bringing babies to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. When the disciples saw this, they rebuked them. But Jesus called the children to him and said, let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter in. I also wanted to say, this was brought to me today, that a lot of times when pastor is given a message, and I truly believe it is through the Holy Spirit that his words come, but often it is words of knowledge of the histories, of the things that we really, really need to know and understand. And I appreciate that so much. He's a wonderful teacher. Today, I was given the word that what Pastor has to say to us today is for our hearts, for us to open our hearts to hear this word.
Amen. To join with me in prayer. Lord, we come before you humbly, knowing we're not worthy of you, but you love us anyway. Still, you have chosen us and poured out your love over us, called us to yourself, revealed yourself to us, and made yourself known that we may know you. And so as we meditate on the words we heard this morning on this message, Lord, I pray that the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts, that they will be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. It's celebrated all across our nation. We have a short video that just talks about the meaning of the sanctity of life that we celebrate on this Sunday. So if you could play that video, please.
I'm Dr. Bill Lyle, and I practice obstetrics and gynecology. And over the years, I have delivered over 4,000 babies. Welcome today, because today is special, because this is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. Since 1973, we have lost over 63 million babies' lives because of abortion. And abortion at its very core is an attack against the image of God. Genesis 1:26 says, after God created all the heavens and the earth, all the mammals, all the birds, and everything on this planet, God paused and he said, let us make man in our image. And that is all of us. Adam and Eve were created in the image of God, and we were all created in the image of God. And we weren't created in the image of God on the day we were born. We were created in the image of God at that moment of conception. When we look at 63 million lives, that is doing evil in the sight of the Lord, destroying the image of God. And this is what the attack is. It's an attack against the image of God out of a hatred for God himself. We look at Psalm 139, where we are miraculously knit together in our mother's womb. The psalmist didn't understand about cell differentiation and fetal development. He just knew that it was knit together in their mother's womb. From the moment of conception, when one cell from the mom and one cell from the dad get together, at that moment, that is a unique new person. Unique from the mom, unique from the dad, unique from the other 8 billion people on the planet. And then we go from one cell to two cells to 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, developing into different systems, cardiovascular system, neurological system, skeletal system. 18 days after conception, we can actually see the heart beating. And the heart is pumping blood from the baby to the placenta where the mom is, and then back. And the babies not only have different genetics, but often the babies can even have a different blood type. It's really a matter of not just a choice, it's a matter of patients' rights and being created in the image of God. And say, well, why patients' rights? Because we treat the babies in the womb as patients, and a patient is a person, no matter how small. And I really think that God is looking and saying, you have this amazing opportunity. We have reversed Roe versus Wade. What is the church going to do to defend my preborn, to discuss the gift of salvation and forgiveness, and to provide healing for not only the church, but those outside of the church? Because if the truth is not going to be heard from our pulpits, where do we expect to hear the truth? So the church needs to engage. And the church doesn't just need to know the truth. The church needs to speak the truth. They need to stand up for the preborn. They need to say this is wrong, but they also need to discuss about forgiveness and healing. See how you can get engaged. And if you have any questions, you can contact me, Dr. Bill Lyle, through our website, which is prolifedoc.org. God bless you, and thank you for setting aside Sanctity of Human Life Sunday.
So today we celebrate Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. Today is a day when churches across our nation celebrate God's miraculous gift of new life, his promise of new hope, his revelation of new beginnings. And this miraculous work of God, it begins at the time of conception. And it works throughout the entirety of our lives. This is not simply a discussion about those who are unborn. It is a discussion that involves every one of us. For when we speak about the sanctity of human life, we are talking about those who are yet to be born, as well as those who are infants, children, teenagers, and young adults. We are speaking about mothers and fathers, grandmothers and grandfathers, aunts and uncles, brothers and sisters, cousins, and best friends. This is not a discussion about one woman and one child. It is a discussion that transcends generations, a discussion that branches out across communities and nations. On June 24, 2022, a decision was made in the courts which transformed the discussions and the possibilities concerning the lives of unborn children. Why is it important? because for the 50 years prior to this, the option to terminate the lives of those who are yet to be born was simply an option that was too readily available. Whatever your position, whatever your beliefs may be concerning the right for a woman to choose, I believe we can all agree that is not a decision that should be taken lightly. It is not a decision that should be made in a silo. Yet that is what it had become in our nation. Too often, pregnancies were being terminated out of convenience, and in some cases, simply out of preference. Tragically, there are instances in which terminating a preborn life is necessary. When pregnancy threatens the life of the mother, terminating the pregnancy must be considered. In cases of rape or incest, the decisions become much more difficult. Yet a discussion must occur even in these situations before a decision is made. Just the past week, I read an article about a woman in Florida who chose to keep her child who was conceived as an act of rape by a Lyft driver of all people. In her words, she says, "I love my kids so deeply, but there are a lot of mixed emotions when the biggest blessings in your life can also remind you of the darkest hour. When decisions involve a risk to life or violent crimes, then the decision needs to be made by the one who bears the life, with counseling and in prayer." I recall the testimony of a Spirit West Coast pastor who was conceived by a mother who was a prostitute, one who was addicted to drugs. Despite many people encouraging her to abort her child, including doctors and drug counselors, she chose to give him life. And his early life was difficult. He was placed in the foster care system where he suffered both physical and sexual abuse. As a young teenager, he became involved with theft and with drugs. It seemed as if his life would not amount to anything good. However, at the age of about 16, a person shared the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ with him, and it penetrated him in his heart and in his soul. He accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. He turned from theft and drugs, and he went on to become a pastor and an evangelist. The short story is that God has a plan and a purpose for every one of us. Amen. For every one of us who is given the opportunity of life. From our reading from the Psalms this morning, God reveals to us how he is involved in every area of our life, beginning from the time of conception. For when we consider the lives of those who are unborn, we must also consider their lives after they are born. We must consider the life God has planned for them. We must consider our part in their lives. For all the days of the Lord for their lives has been planned for them. For God knows every one of our days. In this psalm, David praises God, the one who searches his heart, the one who knows his comings and his goings, the one who knows the places in which he dwells. To be known by God is to experience the presence of God in your life. It's an experience in which you know God as you are known by God. An experience in which God is revealed to you as you become fully revealed before him. When the scripture says the Lord searches our heart, it means that he examines our hearts intimately, penetrating our hearts and our minds, knowing every thought and every desire of our being. And all that we do, nothing is hidden from him. There's no place we can go where we can hide. David declares, from the highest heavens to the deepest recesses of the earth, God is there. From the wings of the morning, that is, from the rising of the sun to the uttermost parts of the sea in which it sets, God's hand will be upon us to lead us and to guide us, to take a hold of us in all that we do and all that we desire and all of our struggles, in every failure and in every victory. Yet this story does not begin at a birth, at our birth. It begins at the time of conception. When David says, even the darkness is not dark to you, he is revealing to us that even in our mother's womb, God's hand is upon us. For within the darkness of the womb, he knows us and he forms us, knitting us together according to his design for our lives. For every one of us is fearfully and wonderfully made, set apart for God. Each of us is as unique and distinct as our own fingerprints. Praise be to God. From Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, Ephesians 2:10, the apostle writes, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand so that we should walk in them." In our Christian walk, we must consider every life precious and valuable before God. Even in difficult circumstances, we must learn to trust that God has a purpose for that life which has been created, the life that is yet to be born. David declares, "You saw, your eyes saw my unformed substance, and your books were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them." What does this mean except that even before a woman knows that she is pregnant, that God's hand is upon her newly conceived child? You see, our life before God begins in the womb, where God has laid out the full course for all of our days. In our gospel reading, which we heard this morning, Luke tells us that the people of Israel were bringing even infants to Jesus, that he might touch them. The Greek word translated as infants is brephos, which means both an unborn child and a newly born child. Jesus instructed his disciples, saying, "Let the children come to me and do not hinder them." Here the word translated as children means a little child, a little one, and an infant. And so we can imagine that pregnant women and mothers with children of all ages were coming to Jesus so he might bless their children, those who are newly born and those who are yet to be born. When Luke says they were bringing, it suggests that this was a frequent occurrence in Jesus' ministry, as other scriptures from the Gospels reveal. They brought their children to him that he might touch them, so that he may lay hold of those who are precious in his sight, that he may bless them and kindle his spirit within, and those who were born and those who were yet to be born. And it was common for women to bring their children to Jesus for his blessing, and likewise it was also common for children to surround Jesus in his ministry. In the Gospel of Matthew chapter 18, we find Jesus ministering to his disciples. And his disciples ask him, they say, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus called the little child to himself, and he put the child in their midst, and he said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." You see, when Jesus placed the child in the midst of his disciples, he established that little one as a person who is of great worth, a person of great value, one who, from whom we can learn about the secrets of God. For in this time, children, they had no authority or power. Like children today, they were completely dependent upon their persons and loved ones for everything that they need for life. Jesus teaches his disciples that unless they become like children, they will never enter the kingdom of heaven. And why is that? Because the humility of a child consists of childlike trust, of vulnerability, and the inability to advance his or her own cause, their own life, apart from the help, the direction, and the resources of a parent. This is why Jesus tells us, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. For only when we come to the point of confessing that we are completely dependent on God, our Heavenly Father, for everything we need in life, only when we humble ourselves like a child will the greatness of God mold us, shape our lives according to his purpose and according to his desire. In this passage, Jesus admonishes his disciples, saying, whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. Therefore, see that you do not despise even one of these little ones. The Greek word translated here as despise means do not disregard. Do not disregard children, for they are precious in the sight of Jesus. And we are charged with their care. Jesus instructs his disciples in this way. He says, it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. Not one. For every one of them are precious in his sight. So they should be precious in our sight as well. Today there are many options available to men and women who may doubt whether they are able or ready to care for and raise a child. Who may doubt whether or not they are ready to be parents. And quite frankly, there are many in the world today who are not ready or prepared to care for and love the child that has been conceived. But before any decisions are made, discussions must be had. My wife, Joy, has testimonies from her experiences from volunteering and working in pregnancy help centers in both Sacramento and Merced, where women and men can get guidance on what options are available to them, where they can take advantage of free resources and even prenatal care. At these pregnancy help centers, they will take as much time as necessary to answer all the questions that a couple may have, to make sure they are fully informed on their options and the resources that are available. If they choose to raise the child, they can take advantage of free counseling and parenting classes to equip them and prepare them to be the parents that God created them to be. They often come to the point of realizing that they have a tremendous network in their extended families and friendships. And many come to realize that they have a God who loves them and their unborn child. And if they choose not to raise the child, there are many options available for adoption. Options that include prenatal care and more. You see, in our Christian faith, we do not simply advocate for the life of the unborn child. We advocate for the life of the mother and the father, be it the biological parents or the adoptive parents. As for myself, I have raised 4 children. None of them are my own progeny. None of them are my biological children. From a previous marriage, I adopted 2 young boys through foster care. And if it were not for the willingness of their biological mother to give life to them, I would have never known the joy of raising these 2 young boys from the ages of 3 and 4. I'm also blessed to have 2 other children whom I've come to know and love in my marriage to Joy. You see, God has a plan and a purpose for every one of us, if only we are willing to trust our lives to him, even in times of great difficulty, even when we cannot see the way forward. In most cases, all we need is a little encouragement to trust and believe in God's plan for our lives. All we need is someone willing to walk with us, someone willing to pray with us, as we work out what God would have us do. Sometimes a promise of new life can create chaos and confusion in our own lives. Sometimes people do not have others in their life to encourage them in the ways of God. This is a sad truth. Sometimes we make decisions which we later regret or that we may grieve. And far too often, men and women grieve a decision to end the life of an unborn child. Far too often, they suffer from issues of post-traumatic stress disorder related to the abortion of a child. And it is in these times that sharing our faith is of the utmost importance. Reminding those who are suffering that we have a God who knows our pain. A God who knows our suffering and our grief. We have a God who forgives, a God who restores, a God who offers new life when we trust him enough to turn to him, to lay our burdens at the foot of the cross, and to receive the love and the forgiveness which he alone offers. For the Lord is good. He is a refuge in times of trouble. He cares for those who trust in him. In Psalm 34, verse 22, David declares, "The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned." And from Romans 8, 1 and 2, we receive this promise. "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death." And this is the promise that we have in him. Whatever is good and perfect is a gift coming down to us from God our Father, who created all the lights in the heavens. He never changes or casts a shifting shadow. He chose to give birth to us by giving us his true word. And we, out of all creation, we became his Christ possession. I want you to know that you, every one of you, are precious in God's sight. And that all who confess Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior become children of God and heirs to his kingdom. For we have a good, good Father who knows us, who loves us, and who offers to us the promise of an eternal life with him. It is for this, it is for all of these things that we give all praise, honor, and glory to God our Father, to Christ the Son, and to God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Now let us take this time to lift up our offering to our Lord, our God. Those who have given it, bless those for whom they are given, and use them to advance your kingdom for your purpose and your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to remain standing for a closing hymn, Good, Good Father.
Tender whisper of love, deep and tender.
Good, good Father, who knows us in our comings and our goings and our wakings and our sleepings and the places in which we dwell, even from the time that we are conceived, Lord, you have planned out all the days of our life, and so we praise you and we honor you and we glorify your most holy name. Lord, I pray your blessings upon this body. Fill us fresh with your Holy Spirit this day. Put a spirit of boldness in our hearts and upon our lips to declare your glory to all who have eyes to see and ears to hear. Let us be the light in the darkness, the hope to those who are feeling hopeless, Lord God. Let us go out this day to love and to serve you. Let us go out this day in peace. Amen.